I'd like to introduce first of all His Excellency, our Ambassador, Reuben Levermore. Please give him a nice round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. He's also an All Black supporter as well, which is good to know. And it's my honour as well to introduce, no doubt many of you know already, Her Excellency, GSNA, the Director General of the National Bank of Cambodia. Please a round of applause. And also a New Zealand alumni from Auckland University. But it should have been Auckland University. It should have been Auckland. No, it was Wellington. That's okay. I'm from Auckland. Please a nice round of applause again, please, for Her Excellency, GSNA. Very, very smart, intelligent lady. You heard her on a panel recently as well. And of course, we have Neil Wilford from IDP, who's in charge of a lot of scholarships for the alumni and people studying in New Zealand. A nice round of applause, please, starting from here all the way around. Thank you, Wilford, to have you there. And we have the very most, I've been told, the most reverend honourable, Dali as well. Please give Dali a round of applause as well. Be the first person.
Sorry, Todd.
Yes.
Can I just jump in?
You can jump in into the pool anytime.
This might be a good opportunity to get the thank yous out of our quickly first.
Okay, sure.
No doubt when people will stop listening at that time. So, firstly, we want to thank Kaylian with Maison Bienvenue for kindly letting us use this fantastic venue. I would highly recommend the space for corporate other venues in my mind, because it's, as you can see, the settings are excellent, and the staff have been very helpful. Also, Chea Town Luxa with ADD Wines. They may be slightly off the time, but they always get there in the end, right? So thank you for her lovely wine.
Round of applause for
sponsoring us. Also, look, I just want to take this opportunity to finally thank also Reuben for the time that he's invested with us here. I think it's really through his efforts over the last 6 or 7 months that we've actually started a stronger, meaningful connection and have got us somewhere now where we feel like we can actually have a New Zealand association that's actually connected back to New Zealand and meaningful. So I'd like to all of us give Reuben a big hand for helping us get going.
I see that hand.
Reuben, it's not going to be a tricky one, but could you just briefly tell us how would you see the bilateral relationship with Cambodia in terms of what are the priorities for the New Zealand government?
Thank you, Zoe, for that question. Zoe, if you don't know, is a former colleague of mine at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and Trade in Wellington, and we saw each other tonight for the first time in 10 years. But may I say, first of all, just what a pleasure it is to be here, to be back in Phnom Penh. Unfortunately, it's only a short stint that I have as ambassador. 15 months, I'll finish in 2 weeks' time. And this is my fifth visit this year to Phnom Penh. And each time I've really enjoyed it, and I've enjoyed getting to meet some of the people here tonight. I want to thank Da especially for having organised this evening, and to our Alumni Association for establishing themselves. We're very proud of you. I'll try and answer your question, Zoe. I mean, in short, I think diplomats like talking in flowery language about bilateral relationships, and in many ways, when you bring it down to its basics, relationships are about people. But when we talk about New Zealand and Cambodia, often we find ourselves talking about development assistance, because for decades New Zealand has been providing in one form or another development assistance to Cambodia, and for good reasons. But I think today we have a very comprehensive development program, and part of that program is the scholarships that many of the alumni here have won to study at universities in New Zealand, English language training for government officials. We do other things in agriculture, in tourism development, but it's really the education that comes up time and again in the political level meetings. And whether it's in Cambodia, Laos or Myanmar, that is the one that the governments are really asking us for the most. But I think it's a mistake if we just focus on aid and development, and I think it's actually not very complementary to Cambodia, because in New Zealand we find ourselves thinking in a mindset of a poor country. And I think one of the things that's really exciting to me when I come back to Phnom Penh is to see the change. I came here as a tourist first 7-8 years ago. I know people tonight like Brian and Kevin who I've met for the first time who've been here 20 years, seen enormous change. What I noticed was the traffic on the streets, and that's a sign of economic development. And I think it's important now that if we can, we encourage New Zealand businesses and business people to also start thinking about the opportunities here so that we broaden our mindset and broaden our focus. So that's one of the reasons I'm so happy that we have this association that's formed now. And I'm also really happy that we're harnessing the talents of our alumni, because the reason we send them to New Zealand is so you can get an education and apply it back here in Cambodia. And I'm seeing that. And with people like KSRA, we're very, very lucky to have the benefit of your experience and the collective experience of people in this room. So it is about people, and it's about harnessing the strengths and the backgrounds that people have. Because if our businesses do come here in greater numbers eventually, they're going to need to understand this country and how to operate. And that's where I think that the associations can really help. That's a very long answer. I promise to be shorter next time.
Oh, excellent. Thank you.
Can I ask a question as a follow-up?
You may.
Will we have a New Zealand embassy here? So yes or no?
Will we have what, sorry?
An embassy in Phnom Penh.
Yeah. That's another question.
And you promise to be short? So yes or no?
No. This is, the diplomat says, I will report back to my capital. So actually, when we had our Minister of Foreign Affairs visited here in August, a number of the very bold alumni with their New Zealand educations said to the Minister, when are we going to have an embassy in Phnom Penh? And I thought that was great, because he's the guy that makes the decisions. There's no current plans, but at the moment there are 10 members of ASEAN. We have embassies or representation in 7 of the 10. I find it personally inevitable that at some stage we will have a presence in Phnom Penh, but when, I don't know. New Zealand is a country of 4.5 million people. We have 50-something offices around the world. We're not in every country, but I think if Cambodia continues to develop, and to be honest in particular, I think if businesses begin to come here, that will command more attention from our government.
I think one of the reasons why the idea of a New Zealand Cambodian Business Association is interesting and appealing is that it would be great for all of us to develop more connections, more businesses in New Zealand who become interested in Cambodia, and also on those veins. Reuben's obviously going to be back in the capital, and the BMI there knocking around doing something kind of important. So we have our man in Wellington, and I think all of those things, if the NZCBA can help build some bridges, some connections, a lot of business interests from New Zealand, then from also within government, I think that will all eventually a lot quicker.
Your Excellency, would you like an embassy in Phnom Penh? Yes, that's a good answer. Yes, okay, thank you. We've had a question so far about bilateral relations, about the quality of our alumni, and as we talk to the alumni, you will see straight away, you'll get that sense of these are quality people giving back to Cambodian society, and have had some input from New Zealand as well, which is great to see. And we've had a question about an embassy in Phnom Penh. Another question from the floor. Thank you, sir. If you could say your name. If you want to say your name, you're welcome to.
Hi, Ruben. I'm Ock, originally Christchurch. I've been here for, let's say, 2002. Been pretty much involved with the mobile network.
Yeah.
I have to say, like, Cambodia has a lot of potential, and it would be pretty good if these bilateral relationships between the two countries, especially, like, you know, New Zealand takes the lead in the world for primary products. Cambodia lacks a lot of resources that it once had. A lot of these skills, yes, they come from the young alumni. I myself was very lucky to be in New Zealand, to grow up there, to have an education there. Currently in Cambodia here, we own a 4G network. One of the first companies to actually put a 4G network in Cambodia. We also have network services in Laos, and we were looking into Myanmar and Vietnam. So my it's not more of a question, but more of a say like a compliment, you know, for what he said about education. And yes, we shouldn't be just concentrating in just the one path, say like assistance. Without the young training of the younger generation, bringing them up to speed, they are the key to working with the younger generation over in New Zealand and bringing out their ideas, their cooperation, and making, you know, the two economies a better place as well as the world. So I'm glad to have you on board, and I'm glad to be part of Kiwi as well as Cambodia.
Well, I think we should all give a round of applause to Mark from Christchurch. Thank you, Mark from Christchurch. I was in Shirley before coming to Cambodia. There's another Cambodian proverb that says that the young people are like the Phnom Penh, Phnom Penh, right? The young people are like the bamboo shoots, or like the saw, like the pillars. So keep investing in the youth of Cambodia, please, New Zealand. Do we have another question from the floor? Okay, I'm going to just throw this over to Paul. What's your name, sir? Can I ask you?
My name is Greg, but you can see here and there, surely some project coming up for constructions and campaign, influenced by Singapore, condominiums that depend or have the ambition to develop more ecological architecture, which is one of the well-reputed know-how in New Zealand. Do you think this is the kind of industry where New Zealand will take place in the next years?
I think that's a very interesting possibility, but I think it would be a mistake for me as a diplomat to try and predict what business is going to do. All I would say is that New Zealand is very well known for exports of products like our agriculture products, our dairy products and so on, but actually sometimes we overlook the services and architectural services, environmental services. There's a lot of potential in Asia as Asia urbanizes, and I think that at the moment Cambodia is a little off the radar of New Zealand businesses in New Zealand. And one thing I would like to encourage is that they start to look more at this region as a region. The Mekong region, it's a growing region. I'm in Bangkok, and I see some New Zealand services companies that are based there. They're in a prime position to be able to explore opportunities in Myanmar, in Cambodia, in Laos. And I think that's real potential when they can start to look at the regional opportunities. So at the moment, I don't know the answer to it, but I'm sure in the long run that there are many opportunities there.
Okay. We value New Zealand gender balance. So I'm going to hand the microphone over to Nikki. You have a question. We've only had questions from the men so far, and Her Excellency as well. You have a question?
Post
present, future, obviously huge relationship with scholarship awards and self-funded candidates to New Zealand, which, as you know, I'm incredibly proud of as a New Zealander. Where do you see it going? I mean, I'm sure Reuben's got a lot to say on this, but from the IDP, as you expected, what are your comments?
Thank you. One of the key things that I think about New Zealand is, as Reuben said, there's only 4 million people there, but the commitment to the education, certainly to the region, is enormous in perspective of the size of the nation. New Zealand offers 35 scholarships per year, just for Cambodia alone. And that commitment is slowly increasing. There are now, if we look at privately funded as well as NZAS, the New Zealand ASEAN Scholars Program, there's more than 300 Cambodians now who are currently graduating from bachelor, masters, and PhD degrees from New Zealand institutions. One of the important things about New Zealand taking a more prominent role, if you like, both in Cambodia and in the region through the establishment of the New Zealand Alumni Association of Cambodia, through the establishment of the Business Association, is that New Zealand is getting a higher profile. It's becoming a more well-known and it's becoming a more popular destination for people to make their educational choices to go there. One of the things, IDP assists Cambodians to study in 5 countries, New Zealand, Australia, Canada, the UK, and the USA. One of the things that often strikes us is the positive experiences that alumni have when they come back from New Zealand. They're overwhelmingly positive about their experiences. We do a lot of work with the reintegration of alumni when they come back, support services through alumni associations, with business associations. And the New Zealand alumni are unique in terms of how well they feel integrated into the society when they're there, even only for a short time. How much fun they had, how welcoming they felt that the people were. And New Zealand is certainly on the radar, but it's also considered, it's better value for money for people as well. Countries like Australia, like the UK, are becoming far more expensive. And the quality of life which is available, and the opportunities that are available in New Zealand are very considerable. Looking to the future, and I'd like to touch on the gentleman's question about the architecture as well, especially. One of the biggest problems that Cambodia is facing at the moment is a skills gap in terms of what people are choosing to study and in terms of how the economy is developing and what opportunities are available in the workplace, especially looking towards when ASEAN economic integration occurs at the end of this year. There is a massive gap, and we know from experience, certainly from the New Zealand scholarship side, and this happens with the British scholarships, with the Chevening, with the Australia awards as well, there's a massive need for more Cambodians to be studying technical skills, degrees in engineering, degrees in science, degrees in mathematics. There's a massive shortfall in the needs for the employment opportunities that are available here now. They are some of the highest paying jobs, and those jobs are available. And the scholarship programs have trouble filling those spaces. Architecture is one of those things. If you look at the technical side of the agriculture support that New Zealand provides in terms of if we look at supply side, if we look at dairy, all of these scholarships are actually available. What Cambodia QnA needs to do looking to the future is to encourage more people to study those subjects. 85% of the population here are engaged in agriculture. I think only 6% of people engaged in education study agriculture. Agriculture is one of the ways forward for Cambodia in terms of its economic development. And New Zealand in particular is particularly trying to encourage studies in that, I think. So in terms of moving forward, there needs to be more people choosing to study technical subjects, science, maths, technology, engineering. There needs to be more focus on the technical side of the agriculture. And I'm very pleased, you know, we're very proud to be here today with the Business Association. And I would encourage the alumni especially to engage as much as they possibly can with the Business Association. Because one of the key aims of the scholarships is that when alumni come back, they work as de facto ambassadors for the nation, essentially. They are the eyes and the ears of the government on the ground. And as the ambassador said, they're trying to encourage more and more New Zealand companies to invest here, to come here, to provide employment. And the alumni are the ideal employees for those companies because they understand how New Zealand works, they understand the ethics of the business, the technical sides of the business. So looking forward, it's very, very positive. There's still a long way to go. But I think it's quite rosy. I hope that answers the question.
Thank you, Mayor. So New Zealand is a well sought after place, so it's a great place to go and study. There's a lot of gaps that New Zealand educational institutions can fill. Thank you for IPP's role in that as well. And we also have the Rugby World Cup there as well. I forgot to mention that. We have another question over here. I know you're raising your hand, but I'm going to go to the lady behind you. Is that okay? We say Sophia, oh, let the ladies go first, and then I'll come back to you, sir. Thank you.
That's a good question. Thank you for that question. That is, I think, exactly the intent and the goal of the New Zealand Cambodian Business Association, and obviously one of the main goals of the alumni as well. How? Firstly, I think we've taken the first steps. I think we're there. I think that's a major step. I think the next step is, and this is where it really is a very good question. I think that there are a lot of innovative businesses in New Zealand that would be very interested in Cambodia. However, they have a complete lack of understanding of the country. So I think one of the things that we can do as an association, in terms of the Business Association, is to open the connection back to New Zealand. I think that is where a lot of that is where we want to be multifaceted. We don't want to be in an association that is just inside Cambodia, about Cambodia. So with the different people we have on board, we have connections back to New Zealand. We have a lot of people in business back in New Zealand who are successful in business back in New Zealand. So one of our first messages is to, and we are starting that bridge. There's the ASEAN New Zealand Association, there's the ASEAN Forum Association, there are many, many associations in New Zealand. So now we just connect, and also with the alumni, at least we can provide this portal and say to these people, if at first we can share, the whole idea is that we all share information. So we hope that when we establish the website or the online media, the alumni, all the New Zealand business owners here, entrepreneurs here, also whatever we are on the government side that wish to announce, we can share with our connections back in New Zealand. And I think that is one of our goals between firstly having Reuben back in Wellington, I think it's a great asset, and having people like Grant here, myself or my friends are far more successful than I am. There have been many entrepreneurs back in New Zealand who would be very interested in what the opportunities are here. So, in short, the answer is how we can do that is to provide a portal, to provide an online sharing of information. New Zealand Trade and Enterprise is already one of our partners and sponsors, will be in our group, as will from Terra and many other New Zealand bigger companies. And then we will also go through the second tier New Zealand companies to join. And then we will ask everyone from the New Zealand Alumni Association and everybody here in business also to join. And then at least via a news feed or a forum, we can start to share. So yes, that is the purpose. So hopefully we've started.
Before I give it to you, Ruben, just to release a bit, I'm sitting next to Ruben, and he's a diplomat. I'm a woman, and I don't know if you heard a joke about the difference between a diplomat and a woman.
It's not a joke, I can tell.
So, when a woman is asked, when she says no, it means maybe. When she says maybe, it means yes. A woman would never say yes. A diplomat, on the other hand, if he say yes, it would mean maybe. And if he say maybe, it would mean no. So whenever I hear you ask Ruben yes or no question, I'm like, he's not going to say yes. He's not going to give you a yes.
Can you give us a maybe?
Joke aside, this is serious, and also to Ruben, is before there is any trade relationships happening between two countries, first and foremost what needs to happen is the movement of people. And at the moment, getting a visa to New Zealand is impossible, or close to impossible. So I think this is probably the first, the first step that hopefully Wellington can also consider facilitating the movement of people, and then only the trade will follow.
Yes, that's a very good point, Serey. I knew this was coming, so I came well prepared. I'm just going to dig my briefing out of my pocket. Without briefing, I don't know what I'm talking about. This was prepared by one of my team in the embassy. Seriously, I'll cut straight to the point on that, actually. It is very important. Because one thing I've noticed in the year that I've been coming to Phnom Penh is people have raised with me time and again the issue of visa availability, and I think the first person to raise that with me in very forthright terms and compelling terms was you, Serey, and that was in January or February. And as a result of that, I did convince the manager of the immigration branch in Bangkok to come with me in March to talk to some of the alumni, to talk to people in business, and to better understand this country and the market. I mean, before I go into the numbers, what I would say is it is a sensitive area. It is a difficult area. I mean, New Zealand is, as we all know, a small country. There is increasing demand to visit, to work in New Zealand. So we do take pretty seriously the immigration requirements, but the trick is to get them at the right setting. And well, what we try and do is make decisions that are in the interests of our country, but we do want people to visit. What I can say is that in the last 2 years, we're starting from quite a low base, but we have seen visa approvals more than double between 2013 and 2015, and the approval rates have increased, and the processing times have come down. So I know people might have frustrations with their own personal examples, but this is the data that I have. And I can say that, say, for student visa applications, we at the moment have around 80% of them approved within 10 days and around 90% within 24 days. That does mean some are taking longer. For visitor applications, visitor visas, there's a higher approval rate within 10 days. It's around 90%, 95% within 24 days. So we do measure that data. It is still going to be the case that people might be frustrated from time to time. One of the new things I want to mention tonight is that you can now apply for an individual visa online. You still have to send the passport to Bangkok, so that is still the case, but there is the possibility for an online application, and we're looking at doing that also for groups. So if we can do it also for groups, that will account for about 80% of the visa applications. We recognise ultimately that we're competing with other countries. So if it's difficult to get a visa to New Zealand, then you know, we're not going to be competitive against our the other countries that are looking for the same things we are with Cambodia. So thank you for the question. I hope that's some way to answering it.
Just to add to that, I mean, the core business of IDP is student placement. All of the services which are associated with that. So that's applications to institutions, processing of visas, all of those services. And I do have to support Reuben in his points there, because IDP have been working to place students in New Zealand for many, many years. And certainly, again, since 2013, there has been a streamlining of the process. When the New Zealand ASEAN scholars come through, we have to place 30 plus people in institutions and secure them visas within a very short period of time. And the amount of time that it now takes and the human resources that it requires to be able to complete that process has significantly increased. The system has become more rational, it has become faster, and that makes it a lot easier for genuine students and people who have genuine reasons to visit. It makes it a lot easier for them to do so. And New Zealand is very aware of that as well, I think, and especially in terms of the education. They're encouraging people to study in New Zealand, and the system is increasingly reflecting that to make it easier for them to do so.
Thanks, Neil. I mean, just to finally add that it is a point, though, that I will be taking back to Wellington, just in terms of our ambitions with Cambodia, that is an issue that we still can work on more. And the only advice I would have is, I know the applications are long applications, but it's really important that people fill them out completely and provide the details that are asked of them. If they do that, then it will be quicker. So thank you for raising the issue.
Thank you, Nick and Anne. Serey, you got a comment there or no? Okay, we must. Is that okay? Okay, sure. We had a couple more questions around me. Just quickly, I mean, Anne's question was about country to country, but also too, there are an amazing amount of Cambodian alumni here, obviously. How many, Neil? 350?
Who've completed bachelor's, master's, or PhDs here.
Sure. And there are a lot of New Zealand businessmen and businesswomen here as well. And so part of, I think, the NZCBA is to help us also be knowing each other in Cambodia and doing business and relating forming relationships within Cambodia. Now, I'd love to see a really good database, a really good list of who we are, and that hopefully could come out of one of these activities. Okay, we have a question over here. I promised this man I would come here.
Yes, my name is Peren Koi. I am the owner and the founder of Maison Bienvenue, and which import and sell in Cambodia for French luxury art of living. So I have a question, and maybe Hongkong lady and foreign excellency can give that point of view. I would like to know if Cambodia is ready for the Asian integration.
Ready as in 2015, but the idea of ABC is not a big bang approach. That means that all the ASEAN countries would adopt it as and when it is ready to do so. Opening up the border, the tariffs, and so on, it will be done gradually. By 2015, I think Cambodia will need. There's a lot for Cambodia to be doing, but I think ultimately we'll have to get ourselves ready to catch up with the other member.
I just would agree really with Serey's point. I mean, she's better placed as a businesswoman or a senior government representative dealing with the business sector to know, but my addition to that would really be to say, you know, from a New Zealand perspective, ASEAN integration is very positive. We welcome it, and we think we're quite well placed. We have a free trade agreement with the whole of ASEAN. We have a history of connections, and now we have to build on that platform. But I think integration has been happening anyway, in reality. This is a process that's already been underway, and I think there's been a lot of misinformation about AEC, because I think governments in the region want to show that 2015 is a real deadline, when in fact the process is going to take time, and we accept that. But ultimately, I think it's for governments in the region to decide how competitive they want to be. I mean, Grant and I were talking about this last night, in fact. You know, you're seeing supply chains in the Mekong region present opportunities for workers and for countries to attract business, and that competition is already well underway. So the countries that can adopt the most competitive settings will attract the business. I mean, that's my brief response. But I know it's quite an intimidating scenario for small countries and for small businesses in particular. And I think, you know, I appreciate that.
I think it's been studied, the Economist Intelligent Unit, the magazine, predicted that Singapore would benefit the most from this AEC, obviously, because Singapore has always been playing the middleman for the other nine countries, and there's no reason it would stop, so we will continue to do that. For countries such as Cambodia, which is about 55 times the size of Singapore economy, it's going to take time. I mean, the benefit we will not reap it right away. But I think being in the race with fast runner would also force us to run faster as well. So, I mean, it's good to be in the race.
Okay. Neil, one quick comment?
Just to add quickly. I agree with this, the analysis, that the idea that this is a deadline and all these things are going to happen suddenly is misplaced. It's a process which has been ongoing for a very, very long time. And in many respects, Cambodia is very well placed. In terms of the liberalisation of its job market, it's quite significantly ahead of its neighbours. The language of ASEAN is English. And Cambodia's standard of English is far ahead in a general sense than its immediate neighbours, for example. We were far more advanced. Yes. Exactly. If you go to the airport in Thailand, people don't speak English. If you go to Vietnam, it's So that's the key thing. And I think there's a lot of talk about free movement of labour and the taking of jobs. I think the government's concern is that the skilled Cambodians are going to leave, not that jobs are going to be taken by people coming in. Is that, again, Cambodians are going to live. Geographically, Cambodia is the most ideally placed country in ASEAN in terms of being a central hub for supply in the region. Its challenge is to develop its infrastructure to be able to perform to that thing.
Okay, we're moving on. We have a question from Graham right beside me here. Thank you, Graham.
Yeah, it's all been very serious so far, so it's time to lighten up. That's what bankers bring, a bit of liberty. So I've got a question for Serey. As an alumni of New Zealand, clearly a very recent alumni, I am interested to know that your experience in New Zealand as a student. I'm interested in both sides of the coin. So when you had that experience, what was the thing that stood out for you when you thought, my God, these people are nuts? And on the other side of the coin, what was the thing that you thought, wow, that's such a special quality, I'd love to bring that back to Cambodia?
And before I let Serey answer that, it's perfect timing, because that's exactly what was on my mind, was a change of tone, which is exactly why do people who go to New Zealand come away going thinking, oh, I like this place, I'm attached. What got you attached?
Well, Greg, I gave a whole interview on YouTube about New Zealand educations. You can check on that. But really, I love New Zealand. The people are very kind. I remember my first experience there was the Kiwi English, which was quite interesting because I was trying to figure out my way from my house to university, and I had to take the train. And I asked my friend, how do I do it? And she told me, you go and buy team trip tickets. And I said, what? Team trip tickets? I said, how do you spell team? And she goes, T-E-N. I said, oh, that's 10 trip tickets. My first day at the university, my lecturer was a Scottish. And I hadn't learned, English wasn't my second language. French was my second language. English was my third language. And then when I was exposed to, I came out from France and I went to Singapore. I mean, you've all heard the Singlish. It was one thing. But when you go to New Zealand and you hear the Kiwi English, it's another thing. And then you go into a lecture room, and you hear Scottish speaking, and I was so confused, and I'm like, I'm going to fail my class back. But, I get out well. I'll say, I like the fact that people ask me, why do I go to New Zealand and why Wellington? The main reason initially was because my sister was already there, and so I could actually live in with her. But I think the school fee was much more reasonable than any other places. An English-speaking country, much more reasonable than Australia and UK and US. Also, why Wellington instead of Auckland? I love the fact that it's quiet, and I think my parents also loved it. 5:30 p.m. and everything is closed, and that's it. You're in your room doing your science.
<Not before. laughs>
Experience. I like the way university was taught. I went to class 3 days a week and about 3 hours a day. So I basically have a lot of free time to, I was supposed to do research, but I think I just had enough for me. And I barely passed all my paper. That's more important, you just pass it and that's it. was deemed to be the most difficult driving license to get anywhere in the world because of the slowness back and forth you've got to use. And I had to use a manual car, not an old man car, to go up the hills, down and so on. But what I'm talking about, traffic and driving license, is that when you see how people drive in New Zealand, how people respect the traffic codes, I think this tells a lot about the people. And I never drive in Phnom Penh, by the way. I've got my driver license, but I don't drive. But I think this is something that we can all learn from New Zealand. It's not just what you learn at school, but also what you see around you. The people are amazing. You got lost, you ask a shopkeeper, she just literally close her shop and take you to the place where you want to go. I mean, you can question whether she doesn't have much businesses, therefore it's a good excuse for her to take you there, but really, for her to close her shop and take you there, it's really something that says a lot about New Zealand people. So, that's in short. I've got 7 minutes videos on YouTube, by the way, on that. Just on that.
Yep. Actually, I just want to add to that Serey was held up as one of maybe a dozen ASEAN student alumni who were profiled this year by Education New Zealand as a way of really selling a New Zealand education. And so we're very proud of her achievements, but now helping to... basically advertise New Zealand education to others. And so yesterday I met the new scholarship winners yesterday afternoon thanks to a great event organised by Neil. And shortly after I got there, I was greeted by four young ladies, all of whom work for the National Bank of Cambodia. And that was a direct result, I think, of Serey's encouragement. So building a monopoly on the scholarships, I think. Yeah, but I do want to challenge the 5:30 because I'm going back to live in Wellington, and if everything shuts at 5:30, I'm a bit worried about that. I think Dar would challenge this. This is the guy who developed the nightlife in Wellington back in the 1980s. What do you think, Dar?
I can remember everything closing at 5:30 in the day, back in the room 70s as well. I think what Chea says is perfect. It's not that as a clear, but the fact that if you passed, you passed, and that was all that mattered. And if you spend the rest of your time hanging around, hanging out, then that's what it's all about. So, it's a nice big company. Very, very briefly, I've got to thank Brian from Smokey the Boar for really putting in an effort and great sausages. And also, we have a question over there, so
I was just quickly going to say, sorry, obviously you didn't see Dar drive around the streets of Wellington when you were there.
That's true.
It would have been an experience. Thank you for answering. Can I quickly say before I hand over to Mr. Silong, that all of the alumni have stories to tell. You all have experiences of studying in the Great Land of New Zealand, and I'm sure that you are great representatives, and you can tell those stories and some of those experiences to your Cambodian colleagues and friends as well, I'm sure. That's very exciting. Thank you, Simon.
Okay, just from you, I share my experience. I got an iPhone and I loved it on the bus on the way home from the university. And the person that picked up the phone tried to call me. I made a call to my phone. And then the next day, I got my phone back. So this is the best experience. But if Cambodia, if I lose my phone, then it's gone forever. So that's a really nice experience. Now come to my question, because I'm a bit of a statistic lover. And I see the trade statistic between Cambodia and New Zealand is relatively very low compared to other ASEAN countries. And I myself is not happy about it. And I want to make something change, like bringing up the trade volume between the two trade volume between Cambodia and New Zealand to be a little bit sizable or bigger. it's possible. But from Cambodia point of view, to get a product like agriculture product into a New Zealand market is very difficult, especially if you have the biosecurity regulation that the product has to pass this biosecurity. But we have a potential that we can compete with other import products, like for example, just pick one like a mango from Chile. A Cambodian mango could be tasted better than a Chilean mango or a Mexican mango. So, but Cambodian product cannot pass this. I don't know when the other people maybe try or not yet try, but I see a lot of potential like a mango, a pineapple, or banana is a very good quality that Cambodia can be exported to New Zealand. Yeah, but the other side from a New Zealand point of view, we lack of infrastructure and also the power. So like a lot of Cambodian places are in that. We lack of electricity, we lack of renewable energy. So my question is that would you, as the ambassador, would like to address this issue and maybe find a paper out how better to be resolve this problem so that the trade volume between Cambodia and New Zealand can be kick up or build up from this? Thank you.
Thanks, that's a great question. And I lost my iPhone and the same thing happened, but I lost my iPhone a lot of times, so I got it back once. But I think about the trade, that's a topic I'm quite passionate about because I don't believe the trade stats. I think they're very misleading. The trade stats show that there were less than $5 million in New Zealand exports to Cambodia last year and only about $5 million in the other direction. And if the trade stats keep showing that, then it's going to be very hard to get attention in New Zealand, certainly in government circles. And I have a feeling that actually there's more product than that. And it just is that those stats show, for a start, goods that are coming out of New Zealand entering the Cambodian customs territory. So if there's goods that are coming informally, perhaps, from Thailand or Vietnam, or even products that incorporate New Zealand ingredients like dairy powder, milk powder, that won't necessarily show up. And I talked to Fonterra about this just a couple of weeks ago, because if Fonterra commits to a market, you'll see the trade stats jump. And they're interested in Cambodia, they're interested in understanding a bit more about the consumer trends here. I think that they supply quite a lot to Vietnam and Thailand and to a range of companies. But it's not just about Fonterra. I think that consumer market's growing here, and that will see eventually an increase in the numbers. But the other thing about trade stats is they don't measure services. It's actually quite a crude form of statistics. So if it's engineering or architectural services, that won't show up. And also, of course, if there are New Zealand entrepreneurs, and there are many here tonight, doing business in Cambodia, then that's not reflected either. So I think part of what we're talking about here is identifying the gap that exists in information at the moment. And it was a great question earlier, and Dar, you went a long way to answering it and talking about the value of a business association. And, you know, we've got the CEO of ANZ back here as well. We've got a lot of knowledge in this room. So I think that part of it is about people understanding the opportunity. For agriculture products, just quickly, agriculture products are really, really difficult to trade. We do have high standards for SPS in New Zealand because basically any disease that enters our country could cripple our economy if it affects our agriculture sector. We're so reliant on it, so that's why the standards are strict. But we are working with all of the ASEAN countries to help them raise their own expertise in this area. And I had that same conversation today with the Ministry of Agriculture. So for ASEAN integration, agriculture really is an opportunity for a lot of countries, but it's a much more difficult sector to do commercially, I think, than many people appreciate. So we can help in that area, I believe.
And also, just briefly on that, from an entrepreneur's perspective, based here, and we talk about products like mangroves, and then surplus and have to dump every year. There also many boutique products, whether it's canned hot pepper, which the world hasn't come to know yet, and as soon as all the gourmet chefs and celebrity chefs hear about it and get onto it, then it'll take off like crazy. And also you get fantastic sea salt. You know, the people paying in New Zealand $7 for a tiny box of Malvern sea salt. And so there are a lot of really good gourmet products here to export to New Zealand as well. And as you say, yes, it's a higher, stricter standard to get through, but there's no reason why not going through the process you won't get through it. So it's just a question of, once again, connecting people at both ends or people taking the initiative here and having a go. I think the market's there. So.
The New Zealand Business Association, traditionally business associations here, help promote the businesses of their country. How much is the New Zealand Business Association going to help get products made here into New Zealand?
That's a good question. So the bigger picture is, what we want to do is we want as many companies in New Zealand and here to join us so that we can share information. In which case, people can express what they have, and they think they can export. Our people at the other end can actually say, yes, we think there's a market for that. Usually that's difficult to do. Usually you have an entire organization like NZT set up to try and do that. And hopefully we can do more of that through all our old connections, new connections, and yes, that's the goal, is to really connect both sides, as opposed to being a business association, not being New Zealanders.